Hi everyone, in this video we'll learn about option liquidity through Python. Before we get started, let's review the packages we'll use. These include yfinance, pandas, and plotly. Let us define option liquidity. In finance, liquidity refers to the ease with which an asset can be bought or sold at minimum cost. For options contracts, there are three metrics we will focus on for liquidity: the bid-ask spread, the volume of options traded, and open interest. Let's review all of them. The bid-ask spread is the difference between the asking price a seller is quoting for an asset, also known as the ask, and the price a buyer is willing to purchase the asset for, also known as the bid. The difference between the asking price and the bidding price is the spread. Liquid assets have a smaller bid-ask spread, while less liquid assets have a larger spread. The total volume is the number of call and put options that are traded during a single trading day. The larger the volume of trading, the better the liquidity. For options, open interest is the number of options held by traders in active positions. Open interest decreases as investors that are long or short their position close it out. The more open interest there is for a contract, the more liquid the contract. In terms of which metric is the most important, I put the most weight on the bid-ask spread. This is because most investors are price takers, meaning they have to purchase an asset at the high point, the ask, and sell an asset at the low point, the bid. This is why having the smallest bid-ask spread is ideal. The table here highlights each of the metrics and shows the effect of an increase or decrease of the metric on liquidity. Before we get into the code, I am going to review a disclaimer. This notebook and tutorial are for educational purposes only and is not intended to be financial advice. The tutorial provides a simple snapshot of options traded at a single point in time. A much more robust analysis would consider a variety of factors, such as if there is an earnings announcement, trading costs, and would also provide a larger amount of sample points to analyze liquidity. Let us get into the code now. I am going to call pandas, and I am going to read in the constituents of the S&P 500 from Wikipedia. We can take a look at the top five rows of our data frame using the head function. We have some information here. We can see that we have the ticker symbol, the company name, and a few other columns that we're not too concerned with. What I am going to do next is create a dictionary that contains the ticker and company name for each of the constituents. Using dictionary comprehension, I was able to create the dictionary. We can see the keys are the tickers and the values are the corresponding company names. Next, I am going to create a dictionary that is going to store the metrics for our options data. As we retrieve information using yfinance, I am going to append the data into our empty lists that we have defined here for each of the metrics. Next, I am going to create a for loop to iterate over all the tickers and stocks. For our Python dictionary, calling .items is going to allow us to access the key value pairs for the ticker name and the corresponding company name. I am also going to create another variable called company data. This is going to create a ticker instance from the yfinance module. I am going to create a try and accept block because not all of the companies within the S&P 500 have options that trade, and in the case that the company does not have options, we'll just skip it over. First, I am going to retrieve the option data. For the yfinance ticker, we have a function called the option chain, which can retrieve the option data. Next, I will create a data frame for the call and the put. And the way that the option chain works is that it is a list of option data, with the first index value being for the call option and the second index value being for the put option. Now that we have that, we can start scraping the metrics that we need. First, I am going to retrieve both the call volume and the put volume. And I am going to combine these to get the total volume of options traded for a given company. Within our data frames, we have columns for the volume and the open interest, which is what we are calling here. Next, I am going to do the same thing I did here, except I am going to do this for the open interest. and I am going to put in the open interest column here instead of the volume column. I am also going to retrieve the last stock price for a given company, and we can take a look at that as a sanity check to make sure that our next metric that we are going to take the average of the in-the-money and at-the-money options makes sense. Now I am going to retrieve the option prices for an in-the-money and at-the-money option. When the price of the underlying asset for an option is equal to its strike price, it is in-the-money. For example, if I have an Apple call option and the strike price is 165, while Apple is currently trading at 165.5, then the call option is in the money. At the money means the strike price for the call option is close to being in the money. If we have another call option for Apple with a strike price of 166 and Apple is still trading at 165.5, then the option is at the money. Usually options that are just in the money and at the money are the most liquid. We will average the bid-ask spread for the at the money and in the money options to measure the liquidity for each of the companies. I am also going to take the average of the call spread and put spreads separately. Now that we have all the data, I am going to append it to our option dictionary, and I will retrieve the data for the company, the ticker, total option volume, total option open interest, the stock price, and the average in the money and at the money calls and puts for the bid-ask spread. And I am going to finish by putting the accept block here, and I'm just going to pass if there is no option data for the given company. We now have all our data. I am going to create an option data frame. I will call it option DF. I am also going to call drop NA, and this will get rid of any rows that are missing data. I am also going to filter out any negative bid-ask spreads. This is just usually an error in the data. Finally, I am going to set the company name as the index. Let us take a look at the data by running df.head to retrieve the first 5 rows. And we could see that we were able to successfully scrape the various option metrics. Next, I am going to graph the 10 most liquid and 10 most illiquid options within the S&P 500. The average bid-ask spreads for the at-the-money and in-the-money puts and calls for the most liquid options vary from 1 cent to about 2.5 cents. Since these are options, we need to multiply the spread by 100 because every option represents 100 shares. So the dollar value of the spreads for the most liquid are $1 to $2.5. In terms of total option value and open interest for the most liquid, we can see that there are a lot of tech companies in this category, including Tesla, Nvidia, and Apple. For the least liquid options, in terms of trading volume and total open interest, some of these can vary from a few dozen options traded or active open interest to, in the case of insource, only a open interest of 19 actively traded options. This is obviously a very small amount. We could see for the day, insource only traded 3 times. The bid-ask spread for the least liquid options highlights how expensive it can be to try to trade these. For example, ANSYS has a bid-ask spread of around 8.4. Like before, we need to multiply this by 100, and the bid-ask spread turns out to be a whopping $840, pretty much making ANSYS an illiquid option. Thanks everyone for watching. I hope that this video was helpful. I included various references if you want to dive more into these option metrics, or if you want to learn more about options in general. I included a video I made on how to price options with the Black-Scholes-Merton model. If you found the video helpful, feel free to like and subscribe. You can also connect with me on LinkedIn, Twitter, GitHub, Medium, and Odyssey. Thanks again, everyone, for watching, and happy coding.